Good afternoon. Let me welcome you to this broadcast. This is a joint collaboration between the United States Army Medical Research and Material Command and the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. This is a well-timed look at the military and public health response to the deliberate use of biological agents. It's another example of our departments working together on emerging infectious diseases. There's no room for doubt. We must join forces to combat the threat of biological warfare and terrorism. The military has invested time and resources in this area for many years. At the same time, public health agencies at all levels have built a cadre of trained professionals to detect and respond to infectious disease outbreaks, regardless of their cause. Today, you will hear how many potential terrorists have turned their attention to the possible use of biological agents. We're all aware of the threats to do just that. Make no mistake, these threats could become a reality that could potentially overwhelm this country's public health and medical infrastructure. The President and Congress have launched efforts to upgrade our public health systems for disease detection and early warning by expanding local preparation and our response capacities. But we must do more. We know we can't win this fight acting separately. That's why it's up to all of us to forge new working partnerships among public health and military, public safety, emergency response, laboratory, and the medical communities. The purpose of this broadcast is to help all of us to prepare for this challenge. Thanks so much for joining us.
This program is presented by USAMRID, the United States Army Medical Research Institute of Infectious Diseases, and the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.
Forty years ago, we prepared for nuclear war. Now the Cold War has ended, and we face a new threat. Unprecedented and unpredictable. It may not come with explosions. It may not come with rockets overhead. We may not see it when it happens, while it quietly infects. Whether you're a soldier or civilian, on the battlefield, or at home, as patients roll into your emergency rooms and clinics, your aid stations and field hospitals, will you recognize the symptoms? Will you recognize the signs? Will you know what to do?
Welcome to the first day of our three-day live broadcast. For the last 2 years now, our satellite programs on the medical management of biological casualties have been enormous successes, and we hope to continue that tradition with the help of all of you out there in the audience. This year, you are made up of civilians and military members. You are docs and nurses, firemen and policemen, epidemiologists and public health officials. You represent local, state, and national institutions. You include soldiers, sailors, Marines, airmen, and Coast Guardsmen. Welcome to all of you. I'm Lieutenant Colonel Ted Cieslak from the Operational Medicine Division at USAMRID, the U.S. Army's Medical Research Institute of Infectious Diseases. I'm going to be your host for the first 2 days of this course. During that time, we're going to review some of the material we discussed last year, but the majority of our program has been completely reformulated and updated. We have with us this year several world-class medical experts in the fields of biological warfare defense and biological terrorism planning. And they're going to be live in the studio with us over the next 3 days. We also have pre-taped interviews with a variety of experts who couldn't be here in the studio. We have several compelling video scenarios and diagnostic exercises that you can complete at your downlink sites. Now, what we're going to do is today discuss the threat agents. We don't have time to discuss every potential agent, nor do we feel this is necessary. So this year, we're going to focus on the major representative agents from the various classes of pathogens, namely the bacteria, the viruses, and then finally the toxins. Tomorrow, on day two, we're going to use a military biowarfare scenario to teach you the proper sequence of effectively managing a battlefield biological warfare attack. On the third day of the course, that day is going to be presented by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, and it will focus on the civilian public health and medical response to bioterrorism. We want you to have ample chance to ask questions during this program, so you can fax questions or comments in anytime during the broadcast, but we've also scheduled call-in segments, and we'll let you know when the lines are open for your live phone questions. Now, you should have received your student booklets, and they should look like this. But due to last-minute registrations, some of you may not have received them. Not to worry. You'll have to share with someone for the time being, but you should get yours eventually. The student packet consists mostly of reference materials, but it does include the site activity, the evaluation, and the final exam that you're going to need to complete in order to get credit for this course. Now, you can download each portion of the student materials from our website. And our website address is www.biomedtraining.org. You can also complete the final exam and evaluation in one of two ways, either with the original scan forms received from your site facilitator or directly through our internet website. We strongly encourage you to use this website for both registration and for completing your test and evaluation. In that way, you'll be able to receive continuing education credit immediately upon finishing the exam. Now, to start us off, I think it's useful to start talking about the threat. And I find it convenient to consider the threat on at least three levels. So today, I want you to consider the strategic threat, the tactical threat, and the terrorist threat. Now, in the military, we are very accustomed to dealing with the first two of those. Military planners for centuries have dealt with the strategic and the tactical threat. But I think all of you in the military also realize that as we reap the peace dividend, as the Cold War is now over, as we become involved more and more in humanitarian missions, peacekeeping missions, and missions other than war, we in the military are being called on to deal with the terrorist threat as well. Furthermore, if you're a civilian public health official out there or a first responder, and God forbid you ever have to deal with biological agents, then it almost certainly will come in the form of a terrorist attack. So what I want to do is talk briefly about each of these three levels of biowarfare or bioterrorism. So what do I mean by the strategic threat? Well, here I mean, what would the Elbonian four-star general think makes a good weapon? His goal is to win the war, to alter the course of global politics. What would help him do that? Well, if you look at it from that perspective, the news for us as public health officials and medical countermeasure planners is actually quite good, because very, very few biological agents have the necessary properties, the downwind drift, the stability in the atmosphere, for example, to make them viable, large-scale strategic threats. That list might include anthrax, it might include smallpox, and it might include plague, but it probably includes very little else. So I think it's entirely conceivable that with a little bit of effort, we might come up with effective medical countermeasures for everything on that very short list. Now, let's switch gears for a moment and talk about the tactical threat. What do I mean here? Here I mean, what would the Elbonian lieutenant colonel think makes a good weapon? His job is to take that hill. What would help him take that hill? Well, if you look at it from that perspective, the list of possible agents gets a little bit longer, because now some of the toxins, like botulinum toxin, staph enterotoxin B, which would not have had the stability to make large-scale strategic weapons, might at least make viable tactical weapons. But still, that list is only 7 or 8 agents long, and still it's entirely conceivable that we might develop countermeasures for everything on that list. Now, just as an aside, many military planners would argue that biological weapons never make good tactical weapons. And that's because biological weapons have one very important characteristic that chemical, conventional, and nuclear weapons don't have, and that's an incubation period. There's a delay between the time I release my weapon and the time I see its effect. And that delay may vary from a few hours in the case of a heavy SEB attack to several weeks in the case of brucellosis. But in general, for most of the agents we're going to discuss during this program, it's on the order of several days. Well, if I'm told to take that hill, I probably don't want to throw my weapons at that hill and sit around and twiddle my thumbs for several days waiting for them to have their effect. So in that sense, again, many military planners would argue that biological agents never make good tactical weapons. But even if you could envision a tactical use for them, again, that list is probably only 7 or 8 agents long. Now, when we switch gears and talk about the terrorist threat, I'm here to tell you that our task as public health officials becomes immense. Because I think you have to ask yourself, what is the average terrorist seeking? Well, often the answer to that question is simply publicity. And if that's all I'm after, then I'm here to tell you almost anything makes a good weapon. And I think we're going to hear some great examples of that problem from some of our guests later on in today's broadcast. Okay, now we know how busy all of you are out there. Therefore, we're offering you the option of viewing only 1, 2, or all 3 days of today's program, or of this year's program. If your time is limited, and if you are in the military, you may want to focus on days 1 and 2. If you are not in the military, days 1 and 3 perhaps will interest you the most. However, I think most of you realize that there are tremendous similarities in how both our civilian and military systems would function in the case of a large biological pathogen release. I think all of you will gain a lot from watching the entire program, and I fully encourage all of you to do so. Now, when you complete the evaluation and exam, you will only answer questions related to the days on which you participated. For each day of the broadcast completed, physicians will receive 4 continuing medical education credits, nurses will receive 4.8 CNEs, and all others will receive 0.4 CEUs. And I'm going to give you more details about that at the end of each day's program. Now, don't worry too much about the exam. We want you to sit back, enjoy the course. The exam will be open book, and as long as you pay attention, I don't think anyone out there will have any difficulty with the test. If anyone at the downlink sites still needs a student packet, please ask your site facilitator to send us a fax. And our fax number is 301-619-4789. And on that fax, tell us how many packets you need, give us your address and phone number, and we will FedEx those forms to you in time for the final exam. Please, no post office box addresses. FedEx will only deliver to a street address, and they have to have a phone number. Now, you should receive those by Thursday, the last day of our broadcast, at the latest. Now, before we get started, let's go over today's course objectives. We're going to learn about several biological pathogens that both military and civilian practitioners should be familiar with. These agents will include anthrax, plague, smallpox, botulinum toxin, and ricin. And by the end of today, you'll be able to describe the epidemiology, pathogenesis, clinical features, and medical management of these various bioagents. Furthermore, you'll be able to identify the characteristics that make a biological pathogen an effective weapon useful for warfare or terrorism. Again, we can't discuss every single agent as we have tried to do in previous years. But I think if you understand the principles of defense and of medical management as they apply to the 5 agents we're going to discuss, then you can readily generalize much of that learning and apply it to other potential bioweapons. All right, let's get this show on the road now for real. I am pleased to have with me today Dr. Denise Koo, and Dr. Koo is director of the Division of Public Health Surveillance and Informatics at the Epidemiology Program Office at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention in Atlanta, and also my commander, Colonel Jerry Parker, commander of USAMRIT at Fort Detrick. Colonel Parker has extensive experience with medical biological defense, having served as chief of toxinology and deputy commander at USAMRIT, then as director of the Research and Development Directorate on Chemical and Biological Medical Defense, and finally now as commander of USAMR. Thank you for being here, sir. Colonel Parker, since biological weapons have been around for centuries, why the recent emphasis on BW?
Well, Ted, the proliferations of weapons of mass destruction, to include biological weapons, has become one of the greatest new threats that we face today. Many threat assessments in recent years have concluded that biological warfare and bioterrorism is highly favored as an equalizer by rogue countries or groups hostile to the United States. And at the same time, we have realized the extent of the biological weapons programs in the former Soviet Union and Iraq, even though they signed the Biological Weapons Convention in 1972. And to get an idea of the extent of the program in the former Soviet Union, one only need to read the recently published book, Biohazard, by Dr. Ken Alibak. Mm-hmm. Dr. Alibak is now a colleague of ours, but he was the deputy director of Biopreparat. Biopreparat was an organization who performed offensive BW research, R&D, for the former Soviet Union. That organization employed thousands of scientists, technicians, and engineers, and had many, many facilities in the former Soviet Union.
I think Dr. Alibek's book is a chilling description of how vast that program was and how many thousands of scientists were employed there. And again, chilling reading, and I'd highly recommend it for anyone out there.
Well, that's true. And further, today we know that there are a number of countries that are trying to develop BW programs. And you just have to imagine if some of the associated the pathogens or associated technologies, dissemination technologies, are just the right scientific expertise were to get into the hands of a rogue country or group that is intent on causing terror or mass casualties. Well, that result could be catastrophic.
You know, there's been a tremendous amount of information in the press and media lately, sir, about biological weapons. And I think most of us out there understand that using a biological weapon can really be as simple as contaminating an adversary's drinking water, perhaps by throwing an animal carcass in a well or using human feces to contaminate that water or food. There's certainly many historical examples that we're going to discuss over the course of today's broadcasts. But Denise, let me ask you, why is our nation and the CDC and public health infrastructure in our country suddenly so concerned about domestic bioterrorism?
Well, actually, Ted, as you know, concern about biological terrorism is not new for us in public health. In fact, it was concern about biological warfare and bioterrorism during the Cold War that led to the establishment of the Epidemic Intelligence Service's CDC in 1951. Dr. Alexander Langmuir recognized that epidemiology would be crucial to the detection, investigation, and control of a bioterrorist event. Through the EIS, he wanted to ensure that we always had a cadre of trained epidemiologists who would be available at a moment's notice to investigate potential threats to the public's health, which included bioterrorism. So really, the question is, why are we more concerned now? And it's because our nation's vulnerability to a terrorist attack has been clearly illustrated over the past few years by several events. In 1993, the bombing of the World Trade Center in New York City was intended to drop both towers to the ground with nearly 100,000 workers and visitors inside. Luckily, actual casualties were minimal. However, this incident led the nation for the first time to seriously consider the threat of foreign terrorists operating on our shores. In April 1995, the Oklahoma Federal Building bombing enlarged our focus to include not just foreign terrorists, but also domestic terrorism and violence. In June 1995, an extremely toxic nerve agent called sarin was intentionally released on several subway trains as they converged at the same time in central downtown Tokyo. This resulted in 12 deaths and over 5,000 people seeking care at local hospitals that day. This event signified that weapons of mass destruction, in this case a chemical weapon, are now a part of the terrorist arsenal. We now know that the religious group responsible for this attack, the Aum Shinrikyo, also had attempted to develop the biological weapons and means of dissemination for anthrax and botulinum toxin, which is 100,000 times more toxic than sarin. So now the concern is that some of these countries with bioweapons program also harbor terrorists and could pass their knowledge and technology to terrorist organizations.
Well, you know, so far, Denise, most of our experience comes from these publicized hoaxes that I think most people in the audience are probably familiar with. And in those cases, the bad guy out there apparently does us the favor of announcing his intentions. I presume, though, that bad guys aren't always going to tell us of their plans.
Exactly, Ted. That's why we in the healthcare sector and in public health have to be alert to the possibility of a biological attack.
Well, you know, before we go further, we need to define what we mean when we use the term biological warfare. According to the definition that we use in crafting the Biological Weapons Convention and in our treaty negotiations, biological warfare can be defined as the intentional use of a biological pathogen or a toxin derived from a living organism to produce death or disease in humans, animals, or plants. And this would seem pretty straightforward, kind of a no-brainer definition, if you will. But I'm here to tell you that nothing about the topic of biological warfare is straightforward. And in fact, even the very definition has been the source of great controversy over the years. For example, the Soviet Union would accuse us of being our own worst violators of the Biological Weapons Convention because they would say that our use of Agent Orange, for example, in the jungles of Southeast Asia, constituted anti-plant biological warfare. Now, we would say, no, Agent Orange was a chemical. If anything, perhaps that was anti-plant chemical warfare, but it definitely wasn't biological warfare. On the other hand, we would accuse the Soviets of waging biological warfare in those very same jungles by employing trichothecene mycotoxins, fungal toxins, yellow rain, if you will, against the sympathizers of the U.S. government. Now, the Soviets have never admitted doing that, but what they have said in certain backdoor sessions, well, we didn't do that, but even if we did, we don't consider that biological warfare. We consider that chemical warfare. Well, I'm not here to argue who's right or who's wrong, just again to show you that even the very definition of biological warfare has been the source of great controversy. Now, Denise, let's turn our attention to bioterrorism. Is the concern or the definition really much different in the case of bioterrorism?
Not really, Ted. What we care about in public health is the deliberate or threatened use of biological agents to harm large numbers of civilians.
You know, Colonel Parker, something that's always puzzled me, USAMRID studies perhaps only 15 to 20 different infectious disease agents. How do we decide which particular infectious diseases and toxins would make legitimate, viable weapons candidates?
Well, Ted, you know, there are many pathogens, hundreds, perhaps thousands, that could be used to intentionally cause disease. Fortunately, not all pathogens are created equal. We try to look at the list of pathogens in terms of a medical risk analysis. So physical characteristics such as infectivity or toxicity, ease of production, stability, allows us to characterize pathogens in terms of strategic, tactical, or limited threat. Fortunately, the list of pathogens thought to have strategic mass casualty producing capabilities is really small, as you mentioned earlier. From that, the agents that we're most concerned about are those that could be disseminated from great distance and cover a large area. The ideal biological pathogen must be stable enough to be disseminated in aerosol form. It should be capable of being produced in large quantities and effective at low doses and stable in storage and in a weaponized form.
What about pathogens spread by food or water? We've talked about aerosol for a minute, but how about spreading some of these things via food or water vehicles?
Well, we're not as concerned or too concerned about pathogens that could be spread through the food and water for several reasons. In the battlefield setting, we generally have good control over our food and water sources, although we do need to take precautions from locally procured foods mm-hmm. in an OCONUS deployed situation. In addition, effective contamination of large water sources is unlikely due to dilution, chlorination, and filtration. And it generally takes an enormous quantity of biological pathogen to significantly contaminate water reservoirs in the battlefield setting.
You know, that's a good point you make, sir. In the military, we're definitely less concerned about cutaneous and gastrointestinal exposures than we would be with disease spread perhaps by the aerosol route. Denise, I wonder, in the domestic situation, would your concerns be a little bit different?
Actually, Ted, our concerns are probably more similar than they are different. In fact, just as in the military, we're also the most concerned about aerosolized biological weapons because of the significant potential for greater mass casualties. However, our mission is to protect the health of the entire public, and there are a greater range of environmental factors that are more difficult to control, such as food and water supplies. For this reason, public health practitioners have a longer list of bioagents to be concerned about, and we'll discuss these on the last day of the show.
Well, you know, I think we have to ask ourselves, why would a terrorist or a belligerent or an enemy go to a biological weapon? Certainly history is full of examples of how terrorists and how potential adversaries can achieve their aims using conventional weapons. So Oklahoma City, World Trade Center, Khobar Towers, all great examples of terrorists achieving their aims using conventional weapons. Furthermore, thanks to the gang down at the Aum Shinrikyo, we now know that terrorists can achieve their aims with chemical weapons as well. So given that conventional and chemical weapons are readily available to our adversaries, why would they reach for a biological weapon? Well, at USAMRID, we concern ourselves with studying that threat, but we like to think that perhaps these are the ultimate terrorist weapon. And I'm going to give you 10 reasons why that might be the case, although I'm sure you can think of plenty of others. First of all, these things are available in stores everywhere. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, there are many legitimate biological supply companies that exist for very legitimate peacetime purposes. And these companies sell microorganisms for scientific study. And in fact, there are 450-some of these supply companies in existence in 67 countries around the globe. Interestingly, 54 of those ship and supply the anthrax bacteria. And you can get these agents from many of these supply houses without a great deal of difficulty. And it's interesting to note that the Iraqis, when they went to obtain the seed stocks to start their biological weapons program, obtained those stocks from a legitimate medical supply company in the United States. So again, they're available in stores everywhere. Second reason why a bad guy might reach for a biological agent as opposed to other forms of terrorist devices is they're available for an everyday low discount price. In 1969, the United Nations commissioned a study, and they looked at what it would cost a terrorist to produce mass casualties over 1 square kilometer area. And they defined mass casualties as 50% casualties. And again, these are 1969 figures, so you can triple them to put them into 1999 dollars. But I think the ratios are instructive nonetheless. If I were a bad guy and I wanted to produce mass casualties in 1969 with a conventional weapon, it would have cost me $2,000. If I wanted to do that with a nuclear weapon, it would have cost me $800. Now, I realize it costs more than $800 to build a nuke, but you also get more than 1 square kilometer worth of bang for your buck. If I wanted to do it like the Tokyo subway gang did with sarin, it would have cost me about $600. And if I wanted to do it with anthrax, it would have cost me about a buck. So I don't think it's too difficult to see why a poorly funded terrorist might look attractively at the biological option. Okay, third reason a bad guy might reach for a biological weapon, no roaming charges. What do I mean here? Well, basically, the seed stocks necessary to produce biological programs and biological weapons are very, very tiny indeed. With one little vial of anthrax spores, for example, I can start an entire biological weapons program, and I can spirit that anthrax vial around the world in my coat pocket. I can move through radar detectors at airports, for example, without anyone detecting that I'm carrying the seeds that could destroy a large chunk of humanity with me. So again, no roaming charges. Fourth reason a bad guy might reach for a biological weapon, they taste great and they're less filling. And with me in the audience today, I have Lieutenant Colonel James Madsen. Those of you who saw last year's chemical show may recognize Colonel Madsen as the star of that show. And last year, last April rather, during the chemical broadcast, Colonel Madsen probably told you that if you're bopping along the battlefield out there and you see this green hazy cloud float by and it smells like geraniums or horseradish or whatever Colonel Madsen and things it's supposed to smell like, that you ought to duck or get out of the way or put your mask on. And I fully recommend you do that. But unfortunately, in the case of biological weapons, that's not going to happen. The clouds that are generated by the release of some of these biological agents are likely to be odorless, colorless, and tasteless. You're not going to see them out there on the battlefield or in America's cities should a terrorist release them. Fifth reason a bad guy might choose a biological weapon, they won't harm your carpets. And by this, I mean that you can use these weapons to destroy people without destroying infrastructure. So if I'm an enemy and I want to take out an American city, but I want to leave the buildings intact and I want to leave the bridges and the highways intact, then biological weapons is a good way to do that. Obviously, nuclear and conventional weapons come up a little bit short in that regard. Sixth reason a biological a biological agent might look attractive to an adversary, they work while you sleep. Remember, we mentioned earlier in the show that biological agents have one very important characteristic that chemical, conventional, nuclear weapons don't have. That's an incubation period. In general, that incubation period is at least 24 hours in length. In this day of jet travel, I can be anywhere in 24 hours. So I can release my weapon, and I could be soaking up the sun on the Riviera before anyone knows what hit them. Seventh, these agents have been tested and found effective by leading government institutions. We had an offensive biological warfare program in the United States between 1943 and 1969, and we got rid of that program in 1969. The Soviet Union had an extensive program during their heyday as well. So there are many scientists out there, there are many publications out there, there is much information on how to do biological warfare. So if there's any doubt in anyone's mind that these weapons work, that question has been asked and answered. These weapons have been validated by scientists in both programs. Eighth reason a bad guy might reach for a biological agent: what your Uncle Sam doesn't know will kill him. And basically by that I mean, we are not yet up to standard as far as detection goes. We have some great detectors in the pipeline. We are making great strides as far as our ability to detect biological weapons goes. But we are not yet where we are in the chemical arena. So again, if you saw Colonel Madsen last April, he may have told you about the nifty M8 alarm system, which you can position around your battalion and then go about your business, secure in the knowledge that if some nerve gas floats by, you'll get an early warning of that. And that's great. And in the biological arena, we're working on that, and we hope to be there soon, but we're not there yet. Ninth reason that a bad guy might reach for a biological agent is 4 out of 5 doctors who do terrorism recommend bioterrorism. And if you look at the list of bioterrorist suspects out there, you'll note that there is a preponderance of physicians and microbiologists serving as perpetrators out there. And my favorite personal story concerns a gentleman known as Dr. Suzuki. And this is my favorite story because Dr. Suzuki was a legitimate infectious disease physician, a man after my own heart, if you will. And he was studying typhoid fever in Japan in the 1960s. He was going to write his dissertation on typhoid fever, but his problem was he wasn't accruing cases fast enough. So he decided to take matters into his own hands. He infected several of his colleagues with typhoid fever. Unfortunately, 4 of them died. There are many other famous incidents. There was a physician in Kansas City named Deborah Green who tried to kill her husband, also a physician, with ricin. There are a couple more Japanese physicians who also infected some of their colleagues with these agents. There are several microbiologists and microbiology techs that you will hear about in this course. So if it's good enough for the docs out there who know what they're working with, that might mean something. 10th reason that these agents might be the weapons of choice of terrorists out there is that you can be the envy of your friends. And think about it. Some of these agents have brand name recognition, and that's almost immaterial of whether they work well or not. But be the first guy on your block to have Ebola. Be the first guy on your block to have smallpox. And even if the weapons don't work, you're definitely going to get a lot of headlines. You will be the envy of your terrorist friends. So I want you out there in the audience to put yourselves in the role of the potential terrorist. We've told you why you might want to choose a biological agent if you were inclined to terrorism. Now, the next question is, how are you going to get your hands on the agent? Well, I've already told you that these agents would be available in stores everywhere. And that's one way to get them, is to buy them. But there are other ways to get them as well. For example, many of these agents are naturally found in the soil. Clostridium botulinum, the agent that produces botulinum toxin, grows in the soil in almost all parts of the world. So any of you with 2 semesters of microbiology training might be able to go outside your front door, dig up a scoopful of dirt, and culture yourself Clostridium botulinum. So I've told you why a terrorist might choose a biological weapon. I've told you how a terrorist might get his hands on the agent. The next question is, how would a terrorist disseminate this agent? For the answer to that, let's turn to Mr. Bill Patrick, and he, on video, is going to explain to us how a terrorist might disseminate one of these biological agents. Now, Mr. Patrick is a good friend of mine, and he was the head of product development during the old U.S. offensive warfare program before it was halted by Richard Nixon in 1969. So let's turn to Mr. Patrick.
There are 2 major ways of distributing a BW aerosol. Each has its own unique advantages and disadvantages. The first method is referred to as line source dissemination. That is, a vehicle, a plane, a person distributes the aerosol perpendicular to the wind, and the wind then transports the aerosol downwind. This is the most effective way of creating large target coverage because, you see, you're using the energy of the wind to distribute the aerosol. The problem with aerosols that are generated as line sources is that they are very, very sensitive to meteorological conditions. You must always have an inversion or a nair type of inversion in order for that aerosol to go downwind. Now, inversions occur primarily early in the morning, late in the afternoon, or at night. So therefore, biological warfare is a type of warfare that must be planned and advanced. The second way of distributing an aerosol of a BW agent is by point source means. That is, you release large numbers of little bomblets that perhaps are about 3 inches in diameter, and you saturate the target. The advantage to point source release is that you can overcome, to some extent, bad meteorological conditions or unfavorable meteorological conditions. The drawback to point source munition distribution is the fact that the bomblet never distributes all of the material from itself. You have a residue of powder or you have a residue of liquid, which can then be rushed back to the laboratories stateside, and you initiate your identification procedures.
Okay, we've told you why a terrorist might want to be a bioterrorist. We've told you how he might procure the agent. Mr. Patrick's now told you how he might choose to disseminate that agent. Next question is, how can that terrorist get the most bang for his buck? Well, let's listen again as Mr. Patrick discusses some of the characteristics of biological agents that would be critical for weaponization.
Liquid agents are easy to prepare, but they are very difficult to disseminate in the small particle aerosol that's needed for an infection. On the other hand, dry powders are very difficult to prepare. The processes are much more complex, but they can be disseminated very readily into the 1 to 5 micron particle size. I'd like to demonstrate the fact that BW terrorists can manufacture liquids very readily, but in manufacturing a liquid, although the process is simple, it requires a great deal of energy in order to develop an aerosol composed of small particles. The easiest way of disseminating a BW agent, although it's not very effective, is the use of a single fluid nozzle. Illustrated as follows. You notice as a spray, it's creating an aerosol for a very short period of time, but the aerosol quickly falls out of the air because of large particle size and becomes not very effective in terms of giving you an infection. Single fluid nozzle. A terrorist can then evolve into what we refer to as a double fluid nozzle, a two fluid nozzle. Now this material is much smaller as you disseminate it. I hope you can see that this aerosol is remaining aloft for a much longer period of time. But again, even a two fluid nozzle with the amount of energy that I can generate by pushing this plunger is not very effective. You're probably getting only about 1% of your total number of organisms airborne in the right particle size. On the other hand, terrorists, particularly state-supported terrorists, can use small powders, small particle powders, that can be disseminated very easily, as demonstrated by this simple garden sprayer for rose powder, insecticides. Now, I've carried all these visual aids across many, many airports, and I've passed security without ever being asked, what is this material? What is this device? It illustrates one point, I think, very dramatically, and that is our air security points look for devices that go bang, your knives, your pistols, and what have you. But they have not been clued in to what constitutes a BW agent, what it looks like, and how it's disseminated. Now, state-supported terrorists can bring into this country through diplomatic pouch any number of bad actors like tularemia or anthrax. Today, I'm carrying about 200 grams of a material that could very easily pass for tularemia, dry tularemia. This amount of material would cause 50% infections in a building as large as the World Trade Center. It can be derived from as few as 500 blood agar plates and then dried. So you see, it does not take very much material of a BW agent to cover a very large area and infect a very large population of people.
Okay, we've talked about how easy this is potentially for a terrorist to do, how allegedly any terrorist can do biological weapons in his bathtub for a buck. And Mr. Patrick has demonstrated for you now how simple the technology is. Well, I think the question that's probably out there in many people's minds then is, if it's so easy to do, why isn't everyone doing it? Why aren't we seeing large-scale, successful bioterrorist attacks in American cities on a weekly basis? Well, before we answer that question, I want to introduce our next guest. Our next guest is Dr. Seth Karas. Dr. Karas is a senior research professor at the Center for Counterproliferation Research at National Defense University in Washington, D.C. Dr. Karas, welcome aboard. Dr. Karas, you authored this book, a working paper entitled Bioterrorism and Biocrimes, The Illicit Use of Biological Agents in the 20th Century. We've talked now about how easy it is to disseminate these agents, and I want to ask you again, if it is so easy, why aren't they being used more often?
Well, unfortunately, there's been a tremendous growth in the last decade in the number of people who've used or thought about using biological agents. As you've already mentioned, there's been a great explosion in anthrax threats just in the last year. Fortunately, the number of victims in these events has been limited because most of the events have been hoaxes. And most of them have been biological crimes, biocrimes, rather than bioterrorism events.
Okay, you mentioned biocrimes. What distinguishes a bioterrorist incident from a biocrime?
We already discussed what a bioterrorism incident was. I like to think of a biocrime as an incident where a pathogen is used, there's a threat of use, but there's no real ideological, religious, or political rationale for it. Biocrimes usually involve a small number of people, and they're represented in murder plots or extortion or revenge. And they involve not aerosols, but injections or perhaps contamination of food and water.
Well, can you give us an example?
Well, there's an interesting case that happened a couple of years ago back in 1996 involving a laboratory technician by the name of Diane Thompson working in Texas. She contaminated pastries of some of her coworkers with a rare strain of Shigella. She gave the pastries to her coworkers because she was upset with them. In 1998, a Texas court sentenced her to 20 years in prison for this crime.
And I understand that one of the mistakes she made, correct me if I'm wrong, is she actually sent out an email message to her coworkers inviting them to partake of the donuts. So.
Among other mistakes, there was also a camera that was focused on the door of the room that this happened in, so they caught her on film.
Well, hopefully we'll be that lucky next time a terrorist tries this or a criminal tries this. But you make in your paper a distinction between biological terrorism and biological crimes. Have we seen any biological terrorism events in this country?
Well, fortunately, they've been very rare, and they haven't been used effectively on a large scale. The one real example of a bioterrorism incident happened in the United States, and it involved a group called the Rajneeshi, who successfully made more than 750 people ill with a rather common pathogen by the name of Salmonella typhimerium. This was back in 1984. Now, the Rajneeshis were a cult group that established a commune in rural Oregon. They came into conflict with the local community there and devised this plot where they thought they could take over the community by making all the voters sick at an upcoming election. They decided to do a test of the concept a couple of months before the election. They contaminated, among other things, salad bars in the community, and as a result of this, got a fairly large number of people sick. While this was a tactical victory, they did make a lot of people sick, it was a strategic failure in that they were not able to accomplish what they'd hoped to accomplish.
Didn't win the election anyway.
That's right.
Okay, well, it would be difficult, I guess, to affect large numbers of people in some of the ways you've described, but I think it's a real possibility nonetheless. Now, both domestically and in the military, our concern, of course, is the possibility of mass casualties, of casualties on a larger scale than you've heretofore indicated. So, Colonel Parker, let me turn my attention to you. How do we minimize this threat of larger scale casualties?
Well, Ted, there's a lot that we can do to minimize the strategic mass casualty event. And our nation's chemical and biological defense doctrine first calls for increasing our intelligence about our adversary's capability of releasing a biological weapon. Who are they? What agents, delivery systems do they possess or have access to? Second, we must develop physical countermeasures to include improved environmental detection systems, protective clothing and shelters, and effective decontamination procedures. Third, we need improved medical countermeasures to include enhanced disease surveillance and public health infrastructure, appropriate vaccines, therapeutics, and diagnostics. And finally, and probably most important at this stage, is education and training of our medical and public health personnel. Hence, this is why we are here today, to make you more aware of the threats out there without the paranoia, and finally, to raise your index of suspicion in case you are ever confronted with a biological warfare attack scenario.
Well, why are biological weapons and the proliferation of biological weapons so difficult to control?
Well, you're right, they are difficult to control, but there are some non-proliferation efforts and treaties that are helping to decrease the proliferation potential. However, biological weapons treaties have proven very difficult to verify because of the simplicity and speed at which biological pathogens can be produced and the dual-use nature of key equipment needed for their production. The same equipment and supplies that have legitimate research, agricultural, medical, or other use can be misused for biological weapons production. The duplicity of supplies and equipment means that there's no unique signature to a biological weapons facility. The relatively simple equipment that can be used for small-scale production makes it easy to hide illicit activities. Even large-scale production is difficult to locate. And we have to look no further than the UN inspection teams in Iraq to see an example of this. Iraq successfully deceived, denied, and hid from UN inspectors information about their biological weapons program for 4 years after the Gulf War. It took the defection of Saddam Hussein's son-in-law in 1995 to confirm that Iraq maintained a standby biological weapons capability that went undetected despite the most intrusive inspection program ever.
Well, thanks very much for enlightening us in this regard, Colonel Parker. That concludes the first part of today's discussion. I'd like to thank Colonel Parker and Dr. Karras for being here today. And I now want to switch gears and begin the discussion of specific agents. The first agent we're going to talk about today is anthrax, and we're going to use anthrax as our example of a spore-forming bacterial organism.
Is released onto the tracks of the subway system of a large metropolitan area and dispersed by the passage of the trains through the tunnels. There is no warning of this event, and no one claims credit for it. The subway system has 450 stations, approximately 6,000 cars, and uses about 700 miles of track. Trains depart from stations every 2 to 5 minutes during rush hours. If not immediately treated, 500 people will die in the first 3 days. Within 5 days, more than 42,000 people will die, and another 300,000 will seek medical care.
Okay, to help us discuss anthrax today, we once again have with us Dr. Denise Koo. And joining us for the first time is Dr. Ali Khan. Dr. Khan is Deputy Director for Bioterrorism Preparedness and Response at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention in Atlanta. And I want to thank you both for joining us here today. Before we get to the questions, let me give the audience out there a little background on anthrax. Anthrax is a disease That's caused by infection with the gram-positive spore-forming rod, Bacillus anthracis. And when we say gram-positive spore-forming rod, I think most of you out there know pretty much what that means. But the business end of that phrase, for our purposes, concerns the fact that this organism is spore-forming. And that's because most bacterial organisms don't form spores. And the ones that don't form spores need the same things that you and I need in order to survive. They need food and water and love and affection and all that sort of stuff. But if I form a spore, I can get by for many decades without nutrients, without food and water. And anthrax is very stable in the environment in that sense. Now, the word anthrax derives from the Greek root anthraxis, and that means coal. And it was named that because some of the cutaneous lesions in cutaneous anthrax cases are black necrotic lesions that were described as coal-like looking lesions. For those of you unfamiliar with the disease anthrax, anthrax is one of the great diseases of antiquity. And most biblical scholars now believe that anthrax was almost certainly responsible for the fifth plague of the book of Exodus, the plague on cattle. So, Denise, without further ado, why don't you tell us a little bit about the epidemiology of anthrax?
Well, as you describe, anthrax has been a disease of cattle and other herbivores for centuries. During the Middle Ages, it was called the Black Bane because it wiped out the cattle population as well as many people. Man is generally infected secondarily through work with animals or other animal products such as hide, hair, or bones. It was during the Industrial Revolution that inhalational anthrax was first recognized as a new disease. The population at risk were persons who worked in the wool industry in Europe and the United States. When the wool was processed, the workers were exposed to aerosolized spores of anthrax and subsequently developed disease. It was first called wool sorters, or rag picker's disease, and is thought to be the first occupational respiratory illness.
Well, Denise, in addition to this inhalational form of disease, there's also a gastrointestinal and a cutaneous form of the disease that depends on the initial route of exposure. Now, the most common form of the disease is the cutaneous form of the disease, and this represents about 95% of all cases. This form is rarely fatal if it's properly treated. However, without treatment, there's about a 20% case fatality associated with the disease. Now, the gastrointestinal form of the anthrax occurs from ingesting tainted meat of animals that have died of anthrax. And this has a higher case fatality, generally about 50%. And this higher case fatality is due to the fact that people usually don't consider that diagnosis, so the disease is not recognized. The rarest form of the disease is the inhalational form of the disease, and that's clearly the one that has the highest case fatality, approaching up to 90% if you're not treated. If you are treated, you need to be treated generally within the first 24 hours of clinical illness. However, there's very limited human data on this form of the disease.
Yeah. Right, Allie, and as you were saying, anthrax is a relatively rare disease here in the United States. At the beginning of this century, before the advent of control measures such as vaccination of animals and import controls, there were around 130 reported cases each year, most of which were the cutaneous form. But in the last 15 years, there have only been 5 cases of anthrax reported in the U.S., all of which were cutaneous. In fact, there have only been 18 cases of inhalational anthrax reported in the United States in this century. The last case was reported in 1978.
Well, you know, the ability to be infected by aerosol is really only one reason that anthrax makes a good biological warfare agent. Now, to the audience out there, I want to make it clear that there is no perfect bioweapon. Presumably, if there was, we would see a lot more people using these weapons as terrorist devices. But if there's some bad news about this, it's the fact that anthrax is probably the closest thing we have to the perfect weapon for many reasons. First of all, it's readily accessible. And I told you a little while ago how most of you with a couple of semesters of microbiology training could go outside your front door, dig up a scoop full of dirt, and readily culture yourself Clostridium botulinum. Well, in some areas of the world, you could do the same thing with Bacillus anthracis. The spores of anthrax, the spore form, is incredibly hardy, as we've already discussed. Moreover, anthrax bacteria can be milled in a particle size of 2 to 6 microns, and that's perfect for reaching the human lower respiratory tract. Particles much smaller than 2 microns are exhaled as readily as they're inhaled. Particles much bigger than 6 microns get stuck in your nasal mucus, but particles of 2 to 6 microns are perfect for reaching the lower respiratory tract and staying there, and again, anthrax spores can be milled in that very particle size. Now, when we talk about the spore form of this organism, I think, at least from a military perspective, it's useful to consider the dilemma of the ordnance officer. If I'm an ordnance officer and I am charged with maintaining a stockpile of weapons, and those weapons happen to be biological, let's take a look at what I need to do. If I have a plague weapon, and plague is a vegetative organism, it doesn't form a spore like anthrax, I screw the top off my warhead, I fill it up with plague, I screw the top back on, I put it in the bunker, a few days later I take it out of the bunker, there's a chance my plague cultures are all dead. But if I fill that weapon with anthrax, I put it in the bunker, I can come along 50 years later, take that weapon out of the bunker, and it's good to go. So that makes the task of stockpiling anthrax weapons much less formidable. Now, for a little bit more on the history of anthrax, let's take a look at our video roll-in.
The idea of using disease as a weapon gained a new level of sophistication in the early 1930s as nationally funded research programs on biological warfare were developed. The Japanese had a very active offensive biowarfare research program, which included a battalion known as Unit 731. In their program, the Japanese conducted experiments on humans using 15 to 20 different disease-causing agents, with anthrax being one of their favorites. Allied prisoners of war and innocent Manchurian civilians in nearby villages provided an almost endless supply of experimental subjects. When word of Unit 731 leaked to the West, Allied forces began their own programs, concerned that Japan and possibly Germany would gain a military advantage in biowarfare research.
On the third day after exposure, the casualties begin. Dead sheep can be seen further down the line. It is, of course, necessary to confirm that they've died of anthrax.
In 1942, on Grignard Island off the coast of Scotland, the British conducted their first scientifically controlled BW field trials. Scientists exploded anthrax bombs near immobilized sheep to determine if the spores would survive an explosion and retain the ability to infect anyone nearby. Test results showed that anthrax could, in fact, be effectively dispersed by explosive devices and could also remain viable in the soil for decades. This brought home the realization that if an anthrax bomb were dropped on a city like London, the results could have been catastrophic. Grignard Island was declared off limits until it was decontaminated in the 1980s. It's now safe for both humans and animals. Like our allies, the United States responded to the perceived threats from Germany and Japan. In 1943, we began an offensive biological program with a modest research and development facility at Camp Dietrich, which is now Fort Dietrich, Maryland. By the end of the program, we had weaponized a total of 7 incapacitating or lethal human agents, including anthrax. In 1969, Richard Nixon renounced the use of biological weapons for the United States.
I have decided that the United States of America will renounce the use of any form of deadly biological weapons that either kill or incapacitate.
President Nixon visited Fort Dietrich on the 25th of November, 1969. I remember that date quite well because following his announcement of taking munitions and beating him to plowsheds, we all lost our job. And that was a very traumatic experience. But following his presidential announcement on this date, the entire United States offensive program on biological warfare came to a close within 2 years. We destroyed all of our seed stocks. We destroyed all of our production material at Pine Bluff, Arkansas. And we completely got out of the biological warfare business.
Even at its peak, the U.S. offensive program paled compared to the Soviet Union's. The Soviets had a massive, extensive, sophisticated, top-secret program which employed tens of thousands of scientists and engineers in numerous research and production facilities. The Soviets signed the Biological Warfare Convention in the 1970s, and yet their program continued uninterrupted and, in fact, intensified. Our worst fears were confirmed in 1979 when an accidental release of anthrax occurred at a biological research facility in the town of Sverdlovsk. You'll hear more about this incident later in the program. Much of our most recent knowledge about their joint military and civilian program comes from a Soviet defector, Dr. Ken Alibek, formerly known as Dr. Kanatjan Alibekov. He was the deputy director of Biopreparat, a cover organization for their civilian bioweapon and production facilities. Although we had suspected for years that they had continued their offensive program, some of the information he provided was a real wake-up call for the United States. Prior to the Gulf War, the intelligence community suspected that the Iraqis had done research on anthrax, but they didn't know just how extensive their program was. So, as a precautionary measure during the war, about 150,000 U.S. service members were vaccinated against anthrax, and more would have been immunized if the war hadn't ended so quickly. After the war, the Iraqis admitted to producing and weaponizing anthrax, although the weapons were never used. This past decade, anthrax moved from being an agent of concern for biological warfare to the top of the threat list for terrorism. The Aum Shinrikyo cult in Japan, which released the nerve agent sarin on the Tokyo subway in 1995, allegedly made multiple unsuccessful attempts to infect people with anthrax. Since anthrax has so many properties which are ideal for a biological weapon, I have no doubt that we haven't heard the last of anthrax.
Well, as fearsome as the anthrax bacteria is, it actually lacks two qualities that would make it an even more deadly weapon. First of all, compared to other biological agents, anthrax actually has a fairly high infectious dose, or ID50, and that's estimated to be somewhere between 5 and 10,000 spores. So you need to inhale between 5 and 10,000 spores before you have a reasonable chance of contracting anthrax. Unfortunately, though, in a concentrated cloud, you probably could inhale that amount with one deep breath, Denise.
But also, second, Ted, inhalational anthrax is not transmissible from person to person. Therefore, no special precautions are required to care for patients with either cutaneous or inhalational anthrax.
Well, that's a good point you make, Denise. In fact, the fact that it's not transmitted person to person actually makes anthrax a better weapon to the battlefield commander in one sense. If I'm a battlefield commander, one of my main tenets is to maintain control of the battlefield. If I use plague, which is contagious person to person, I throw it out there on the battlefield. It does its dirty work like I intended. But I also now have to worry that when I subsequently want to march my troops through that area, they're at risk of contracting anthrax, or contracting plague, rather, from the enemy around them. But in the case of anthrax, I don't have to worry about that. The lack of secondary aerosolization of anthrax also makes it an even better weapon. What do I mean by this? Well, if I throw anthrax out there, again, it does its dirty work, but there's very little chance that it will be secondarily aerosolized. And the reason for that's not entirely clear, but it probably has a lot to do with this 2 to 6 micron particle size that's required. It takes some effort to mill anthrax into that particle size. When I blow it out there on the battlefield, if it settles out into the dust, it binds to dust particles. It has a static charge on its surface, binds to those dust particles. It's now present in particles bigger than 6 microns in diameter and difficult to get it down into the human lung. So again, it has a low secondary aerosolization potential, and that again, perhaps makes it a better weapon to the battlefield commander. I throw it out there, it does its dirty work, I roll my tanks through, I kick a lot of dust without the fear that my own troops again are going to catch anthrax.
Yeah, but we need to keep in mind that this lack of person-to-person transmission or the lack of secondary re-aerosolization is really independent of the ability of the spores themselves to be well disseminated as a small particle aerosol. You know, in the former Soviet Union in 1979, there was an accidental release of anthrax spores from a biological weapons facility, which gave us a glimpse of the magnitude of downward spread and resulting mass casualties that could occur from an intentional dissemination of this agent. In 1980, we got reports coming through to the Western press about a large outbreak of anthrax in the town of Sverdlovsk. Now, the Soviet government initially reported that the disease was gastrointestinal anthrax caused by improperly cooked infected meat that I just talked about. Very plausible explanation. However, we couldn't get permission to go in and study this outbreak.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, they were so bold as to actually attend an American scientific convention in 1988, these Soviet scientists, and they presented their data at that convention. Whether the scientists presenting the data actually knew the true story is a little bit open to question, but they presented data that seemed to indicate that this was, in fact, a gastrointestinal outbreak. Unfortunately for the Soviets, intelligence data continued to filter out, ultimately including autopsy data. And this autopsy data seemed to indicate that these victims in Sverdlovsk were succumbing to what looked like anthrax of the chest, not the type of anthrax one would expect to see if it were contracted by eating contaminated beef. Well, after the breakup of the Soviet Union in 1991, Boris Yeltsin finally admitted that perhaps military developments played a role in that anthrax outbreak. And in fact, he ought to know, because back in 1979, when it happened, Boris Yeltsin was the local Communist Party commissar for the Sverdlovsk Oblast. Well, after this admission was made, a team of American epidemiologists was allowed in to Sverdlovsk, and they were chaired by Matt Meselson at Harvard. They conducted a very simple, very elegant epidemiologic study. They interviewed family members, as well as some of the physicians who cared for patients, and they conducted some autopsies on the victims. And I think it would be interesting now to turn to Dr. Meselson and allow him to describe the results of his study.
There's an immense amount to be learned from each epidemic of this sort, and one should not let such an epidemic go unstudied because, for example, from this we learned that, although up till then it was only theoretical, that it's really true that an anthrax cloud can remain infectious 50 kilometers downwind. Before that, you could have said, well, maybe there's something in the atmosphere that we don't know about that will kill the spores. Well, it didn't happen there. There was one other remarkable thing that we learned from this, and that was that amongst the 68 people who were reported to have died, and we had information on the majority of them, nobody was younger than 24 years old. No infants, no babies, no children, no adolescents, no young adults. A big surprise. When we looked into the old literature on inhalation anthrax, of which there are a number of reports, including quite a few from Russia, from Tsarist and post-revolutionary times, we also found that there were no young people. Now, whether that really means that young people are less susceptible to inhalation anthrax and perhaps to other inhalation infections is a very important lead, and we would never have asked this question if we hadn't done the epidemiology. And we still don't know the answer, but there's another example of how epidemiology can not only tell you what happened in a given case, but can bring up new questions, perhaps very important new questions, for future research.
Well, I hope most of you found that interesting. What I'd like to do now is move into the clinical aspects of the disease anthrax. Now, I think most of you appreciate, and Dr. Khan has already taught us, that anthrax spores can enter the body in one of three ways. They can theoretically, I guess, be inoculated through the percutaneous route. You can eat them, or you can breathe them in. But regardless of how you get anthrax spores into your system, some of the common pathways of pathogenesis begin to converge. Once anthrax spores are into your system, they're taken up by macrophages, by white blood cells. And those white blood cells do exactly what they're supposed to do in taking up the anthrax spore. But anthrax has a polysaccharide capsule on the surface of its spore, and that allows it to, at least to a degree, resist the killing effects of the macrophage. So the macrophage takes it up like it's supposed to, but it has a difficult time killing it. And what it ends up then doing is acting as a taxi cab and transporting those anthrax spores to the nearest regional lymph node. And it's within the milieu of that lymph node that anthrax really thrives. And it comes out of its spore form, it vegetates, goes into its vegetative form, starts reproducing, and starts cranking out its toxins. And it makes two main toxins that we know of, edema toxin and lethal toxin. And these cause edema and lethality. The edema causes the lymph nodes to swell, they break apart, the anthrax bacteria get out of those lymph nodes, get into the bloodstream, and circulate around to the rest of the body. And if you were to draw blood on a patient with anthrax in this stage of the game, you would see what we're going to show you here on the video screen, the overwhelming bacteremia, bacteria in the blood, overwhelming bacteremia that one sees in a case of clinical anthrax. Now, keep in mind that you wouldn't see this till late in the stage of the disease, but this is unspun peripheral blood out of the arm of a patient with anthrax. I think it's not too difficult to see why patients with anthrax don't do well if you delay therapy. No amount of gorillacillin or cefaclimol in the world is going to fix that. And if that doesn't drive the point home strongly enough, let's take a look at this scanning electron micrograph. And this scanning electron micrograph is of the terminal arteriole in a rhesus monkey infected with anthrax. And I think you can see that that terminal arteriole is absolutely chock full of living, viable Bacillus anthracis organisms. Again, not too difficult to see why anthrax patients don't do well if you delay therapy. And I think not too difficult to see why the Department of Defense is so keen in stepping off on this plan to immunize the force against anthrax ahead of time. Well, I'll get off my soapbox now, but throughout today, we're going to be using a new teaching tool to help us illustrate the clinical effects of the biological agents we're going to discuss. So let's try out that tool right now. Let's go to our virtual hospital and join a group of clinicians on rounds as they discuss what I think you'll find is a fascinating patient.
Hello, Sergeant McCollum. The doctors are here to take a look at you.
Morning, Sergeant McCollum. I've brought Colonel Cieslak. He's one of our infectious disease docs. I wanted to have him take a look at you to see what he thinks about what's going on with you. And we're going to talk a little bit about you in the room here. I hope that's okay with you. Just in a nutshell, he presented yesterday with complaints of flu-like symptoms, myalgia, fever, temp to 102, cough, non-productive cough, and has tended to get worse over the course of the past 24 hours. His initial signs on exam, essentially normal chest exam, except for the fact that he's dyspneic with normal clear lung fields. He chest x-ray was normal on admission, and he's had also a sputum gram stain done, which is unremarkable, as well as blood cultures, and a white count on his CBC about 15,000. So anything happen overnight, anything new?
A couple of things. Not too long ago, he was dropping his sats into the mid-80s. We put him on O2. Had trouble keeping his sats in the mid-90s to high 90s on 4 liters nasal cannula. If you ask him to do anything, move, take him out of high Fowler's position, he drops his sats back down to the low 80s and has some respiratory difficulty. So we've been trying not to tax him.
That's one of the reasons I called you, because his chest x-ray has changed. The initial one was normal, and this one has some abnormalities, which I'm not used to seeing. It's not a pneumonia, but it's something abnormal I want to have you take a look at.
So it's normal yesterday, and
correct.
Today's.
So it has changed. And in addition, he's been on erythromycin and ceftriaxone, and you know, as I'm concerned that he's not improving. So he has one other bit of information that's kind of interesting. He serves on a UN inspection team, and they were recently overseas on a mission where they were supposed to look for chemical weapons, and apparently they found some fermentation technology or something like that. So I had some concerns about that as well.
So how long were you overseas, Sergeant McCollum?
About a week, sir.
A week. And you were working with chemical weapons?
Yes, sir. We went in looking for chemical weapons, and while we were in, we found some biological stuff. So they pulled us out.
So you think you may have encountered some biologicals?
Yes, sir. Do you think maybe I was exposed to something?
Well, it's certainly something we need to check out. If you don't mind, let me take a listen to you. If you could sit forward to quickly take a listen to your chest. If you could take a deep, slow breath. Okay, and again. Well, I agree with you, Mark. He certainly sounds clear on auscultation. At least I don't hear any rawls. But you said you have an x-ray?
Yeah, let me show it to you. See, this is what I was concerned about there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think you've got your diagnosis there. To me, that's a clear-cut case of a widened mediastinum.
Mm-hmm. And there really isn't much that causes a widened mediastinum in the world of human medicine. Obviously, in the military, we tend to think of shrapnel wounds, gunshot wounds to the chest, cause some bleeding, and a widened mediastinum on x-ray. That clearly isn't relevant in Sergeant McCollum's case. So without a history of trauma to the mediastinum, one of the things I think of is inhalational anthrax.
Anthrax?
Yeah, I know that sounds alarming, and of course it is. The good news, Sergeant McCollum, is that you sought medical treatment very early. They've got you on good antibiotics, and hopefully things are going to turn the corner for you real soon. You'll start feeling better. But there really isn't much else that causes a widened mediastinum short of trauma. So when I see something like that, especially given this peculiar history of potentially encountering biological weapons programs, I think you've got to think of inhalational anthrax.
Now, would we expect to see anything on the sputum? His sputum is negative in the Gram stain.
Well, it's certainly worth looking at, I think, but I wouldn't expect to get my answer or get my confirmation by looking at the sputum. Again, anthrax is a disease predominantly of the mediastinum. You tend to see bacteria in the mediastinal tissues, in the lymph nodes, but not typically in the pulmonary secretions. So I wouldn't expect to see it, although you may want to look. A better place to look, though, would be the blood. So certainly blood cultures might be expected to give you your confirmation in this case. Now, the problem with that, though, is that gram-positive rods, of which, of course, Bacillus anthracis is one, tend to be common blood culture contaminants, and laboratories tend to discard those without working them up. So you got to let your laboratory know that we suspect anthrax in this case, and that way they ought to be able to fairly readily isolate the organism out of blood.
So for treatment, are the drugs he's on right now, ceftriaxone and erythromycin, adequate?
Well, you know, endemic forms of anthrax or endemic strains of anthrax tend to be sensitive to virtually any antibiotic you might choose to use. So in that sense, maybe. But on the other hand, if I knew I was dealing with anthrax and pending the sensitivity data, I think I would put him on something like ciprofloxacin. Ciprofloxacin generally recognized as the drug of choice for anthrax. And I would probably give it to him intravenously, and the intravenous dose would be 400 milligrams twice a day. So we may get sensitivity data back in the next day or two. We may be able to change his antibiotics after that. But right now, I think I'd go with ciprofloxacin.
Do we have any nursing concerns about infection control issues? Do we need masks or anything like that?
Well, again, the organism's not shed in the pulmonary secretions. It's not coughed out. It's not spread via that route. So basically, standard precautions ought to be adequate.
What about, he was on this inspection with a number of other individuals. Do we have to worry about them? Is there anything we would do for them?
Well, I don't think his contacts necessarily need to be treated. Again, this isn't a contagious disease, but people who were there in the area with him who were potentially exposed to the same environment probably would be a good idea to put them on prophylaxis. So if they were symptomatic, I would treat them the same way you're treating him. But if they're asymptomatic and we're truly speaking of prophylaxis, I would probably give them oral ciprofloxacin, 500 milligrams twice a day.
Well, Major Nurses, if you could get a hold of the lab, let them know about it, and then we'll go ahead and change them over to Cipro. I'll notify the commander, because I think this has broad implications for potential,
right?
You know, other people and international implications, potentially. Okay. So, well, I appreciate your coming by, and Sergeant McCollum, we'll...
Yeah, it's good to meet you, Sergeant McCollum. You hang in there. I think you're going to do fine once these antibiotics really start kicking in.
So. Sergeant McCollum, I'll be back in a few minutes. Take care of you.
Well, if you were watching closely, you got a quick glimpse at what I think is a real interesting chest x-ray. And I think it's worth taking another look at that x-ray. So this is an x-ray that exhibits or demonstrates a widened mediastinum. And I think it's important out there in the audience to remember that there really isn't a whole lot that looks like this. And since I'm in the military, I'll kind of use the battlefield paradigm here. But if you're out on the battlefield, what else looks like this? Well, the only thing I can think of that's relevant is trauma, is a bullet hole through the mediastinum. So if you somehow suspect, presumably by doing a chest x-ray, that a given patient has a widened mediastinum, and you turn that patient over, and there's no bullet hole through the center of his chest, then he has anthrax. And that's the hallmark of clinical disease. So what I want you to remember from this particular segment is widened mediastinum on the battlefield, in the absence of trauma, that's probably going to be inhalational anthrax. Now, Dr. Khan, how would a case of anthrax appear earlier in the course of disease, say before they had had a chance to develop this chest x-ray finding? What's the take-home message for the docs and nurses out there in the audience?
Well, Ted, what I think the take-home message is that following aerosol exposure within 1 to 6 days, patients present with a non-specific febrile illness with cough and malaise. Now, note out there to the audience, I didn't say flu-like illness. And the reason I didn't say flu-like illness is that unlike influenza, these people do not have a runny, stuffy nose or chorea. They do not have a sore throat. They have fever and this cough and malaise. Now, they may have a brief period of improvement, but after 1 to 2 days, they usually generally suddenly worsen with stridor, dyspnea, cyanosis, and frank respiratory death. Now, the differential diagnosis that the docs out there would have to think about, you've already talked about in the military context. In a civilian context, it would be other respiratory pathogens, including viral and bacterial pneumonias, and then some of the other biological warfare agents, which would include staphylococcus, endotoxin, B toxin, tularemia, plague, and Q fever would be the first ones that I would think about.
Okay, well, thanks. Denise, maybe you could review the treatment for anthrax now.
Well, Ted, because of some concern about penicillin and possibly acquired doxycycline resistance, a recent consensus paper published in JAMA recommends intravenous ciprofloxacin as the initial drug of choice for treatment. Doxycycline is the second-line antibiotic, or penicillin can also be used if there's a relative contraindication to either of the first two drugs. Once the sensitivity of the organism is known, of course, treatment should be tailored to the best antibiotic.
Okay, so you've talked about treatment. What about prophylaxis?
Well, for virtually all strains of anthrax, an oral fluoroquinolone is our first drug of choice for post-exposure chemoprophylaxis, with doxycycline as an acceptable alternative, and penicillin as our third choice of antibiotic. All are generally effective as chemoprophylaxis following anthrax exposure. Once again, sensitivity testing of the organism should guide you to the best antibiotic.
Okay, well, thanks, Denise. Now, Ollie, I want to go back to you, and I want to thank you for helping us with this discussion and say thanks one more time, say goodbye for now. We're going to see both Dr. Khan and Dr. Koo later on the broadcast. We'll see them frequently on the third day of the program as well. Well, let's go to the audience now and see if there's any questions. Audience members, any questions out there? Major Nerges.
Colonel Sislak, I've already had my anthrax series. Say I didn't have this series and I was exposed to anthrax. Would getting the vaccination after exposure help me out at all?
Okay, so you forgot to get your anthrax vaccines, or for some reason didn't get your anthrax vaccines. You're out in the battlefield, you get exposed to anthrax.
Right.
Well, what I'm going to do there is if you're floridly symptomatic, I'm going to hospitalize you and treat you with intravenous antibiotics like Dr. Koo outlined. Assuming you're not symptomatic yet, then I'm going to provide you with chemoprophylaxis, and we would call that post-exposure chemoprophylaxis. And I would do that presumably with oral ciprofloxacin, again, as Dr. Koo outlined. Now the question is, do you need the vaccine now? And the answer in general to that question, at least in a military context, would be yes. So I would start you on antibiotics immediately. Assuming a war's going on, maybe vaccine isn't readily procurable right up at the front lines where you are. But as soon as I could get you to the anthrax vaccine or get the anthrax vaccine to you, I would start immunizing you. And I would give you the doses along the regular schedule. And based on some animal data, we think that it would be safe to stop your chemoprophylaxis after your third dose of vaccine is in. In other words, 30 days down the road, 4 weeks down the road, once your third dose of vaccine is in. Now, what if we can't get anthrax vaccine? We're in the middle of World War III, vaccines in very short supply, little chance I'm ever going to get vaccine. Or what if we're in a civilian context and we just don't have the manufacturing capability to get enough anthrax vaccine out there? Well, then, some public health officials are recommending that we give you 60 days worth of chemoprophylaxis in the absence of vaccine. So in order to summarize, current Department of Defense recommendations call for the use of anthrax vaccine for both pre-exposure as well as post-exposure immunoprophylaxis. But if a patient is already symptomatic, already has full-blown anthrax, then vaccine is not recommended. Not because it would necessarily cause any harm to the patient, but because by that time we don't think it would have any effect on the disease. If you're going to survive, the natural immunity would probably take the place of anthrax vaccine. Now, we get a lot of questions about anthrax vaccine, especially since the Department of Defense has launched its program to vaccinate the force. And I think most of you out there are aware of this program. The DOD over the next 5 years will immunize all 2.4 million men and women in the Army, Navy, Air Force, Coast Guard, and Marine Corps, Active Reserve, and Guard elements. to help me discuss some of the questions that I think a lot of you have out there about this anthrax vaccine program, we're fortunate to have with us today Lieutenant Colonel Randy Randolph. And Colonel Randolph is director of the anthrax vaccine immunization program at the Department of Defense level. Colonel Randolph, what is AVIP? What is the anthrax vaccine immunization program?
Well, Ted, AVIP stands for the anthrax vaccine immunization program, and it's in a response to the Secretary's decision to immunize the total force, both active and the reserve components, against the biological warfare agent, anthrax. Because of the threat that you've discussed, because of the lethality of the disease, because we have this six-dose protocol, it was imperative that we use this very important piece of our force health protection in our force. Now, the anthrax vaccine immunization program is being executed in three phases, basically predicated by the limited stockpile. Phase number one, which we're currently in, vaccinates those forces which are currently assigned or scheduled to deploy to the high-threat areas of Korea and Southwest Asia. Phase two, which we anticipate beginning sometime next calendar year 00, will begin vaccinating the forces being deployed early into those high-threat areas, Korea and Southwest Asia again. And then finally, phase three, beginning probably in FY03, will begin vaccinating the rest of the total force and begin vaccinating those forces coming through our training base.
So where are we in the program now? How many folks have been vaccinated to date?
We vaccinated about 333,000 service members. We've given about 1 million doses. Everyone is somewhere in that six dosing protocol. I, for instance, have had 5 doses.
Okay. Now, we've talked about the 2.4 million active duty reserve and guard members. I assume only military are going to receive this vaccine. What about their family members? What about the soldier stationed in Korea in a high-threat area who's got his family over there with him?
Well, actually, in addition to the military members, the AVIP does include DOD civilians and DOD contractors. We've immunized a number of those who are considered emergency essential. In other words, they're mission essential to our wartime effort. Family members are not able to get the anthrax vaccine at this time, again, because of the limited stockpile. Family members and others who would be within an area of combat would be evacuated through routine interagency agreements during a contingency.
Okay, what about supply? 2.4 million service members, it's a lot of people. Each of them needs several doses of vaccine.
Right.
Is there enough vaccine for all of our military forces?
We began with a stockpile of about 7 million doses. Eventually, the manufacturer, the sole licensed manufacturer in the United States, Bioport, will have the capacity to produce 4.2 to 4.5 million doses a year. 80% of that, by contract, will be DOD's. About 20% of that will be available to sell commercially.
You know, I think you know as well as I do, in the next war, we're likely to fight alongside various allies. So is there a provision to provide our allies with this anthrax vaccine?
Well, absolutely. And up to this date, we have provided limited amounts to countries who have requested this. Basically, there are countries who have been alongside of us in the high-threat areas during Desert Thunder, Desert Fox, and have asked for the vaccine for those forces at risk.
Let's say I'm a civilian, and for whatever reason, I want the anthrax vaccine. Either I'm a veterinarian, or I work in a textile mill, or I'm just afraid of all the terrorists out there and the cultists out there, and I want to be vaccinated. Can I get vaccine? Can I go to my doctor and ask him to prescribe anthrax vaccine for me?
A normal civilian walking in to his pharmacist requesting this vaccine cannot get this vaccine. We continue to provide limited small numbers of doses of vaccine to populations at risk, such as textile workers, such as veterinarians, such as researchers.
How about in the future? Let's say the six-year program goes off without too many hitches, the military is finally brought up to speed, everyone's immunized. Now will there be a supply available to civilians who want it just for whatever reason?
Well, yes, Ted, there will. In fact, as early as next calendar year, we expect the manufacturer capability to go to that 4.2 to 4.5 million. Again, 20% of that should be available for their commercial sales.
Okay. Well, one of the questions I get as a clinician, and I'm sure you've had to deal with this many times, is the vaccine safe? And, you know, I have my spiel that I give to patients, but I wonder if you could give us the official word on that, some of the official data on vaccine safety.
Sure. This is not an experimental vaccine. This is an FDA-licensed product. By the very nature of the way it's made, we would expect it to be safe. It is not a live vaccine, it's an inactivated vaccine. Its basic component is the protective antigen. The protective antigen does not cause disease. Now, in its almost 30 years use, there have been no reports of any ill effects from this vaccine. In numerous studies since 1970, one notably done at the U.S. Army Medical Research Institute of Infectious Diseases, they followed a cohort of about 1,590 people over the course of 27 years, about 10,000 doses of vaccine given to this cohort. When you look at the diseases and symptoms that this cohort shows compared to an unvaccinated population, there's simply no difference in what's exhibited between the two.
I'd like to talk a little bit now about the VAERS form. And I think pediatricians, internists, family practitioners, public health personnel out there in the audience are very familiar with the VAERS form, the Vaccine Adverse Event Reporting System form. And as a pediatrician over my career, I many times have had to fill out or have my people fill out a VAERS form because some child had an adverse reaction to a vaccine. Some child developed a rash after measles vaccine or a fever after pertussis vaccine, etc. I've heard that anthrax is now, anthrax vaccine reactions are now reportable using the VAERS form, and I wondered if you had some data as to how many VAERS forms have been filed and what you're finding in that regard.
Well, I do, and in fact, over the course of the last 29 years, of course, you would fill out a VAERS, or at least since the FDA mandated VAERS. What's most notable in the military, in the civilian world, it is not mandatory for practitioners to fill out a VAERS 1 form. It is in the military. It has always been mandatory. In fact, they have to fill it out if a symptom or an effect subsequent to a dose of the vaccine causes a loss of duty greater than 24 hours or hospitalization of any period of time. Now, the FDA normally reviews these VAERS for this vaccine and all vaccines to look at trends over time, to see if there's any thing that this vaccine exhibits that might cause some problem, cause some concern for its purity, its potency, sterility, general safety. In addition to the FDA review, we asked the Department of Health and Human Services to establish a special civilian medical expert panel to review the anthrax VAERS 1s. That's called the anthrax vaccine expert committee. The AVEC has, as of 8 September, reviewed 314 VAERS 1 submissions on the anthrax vaccine. Of that number, only 17 required hospitalization, and the AVEC has only been able to give attribution, probably caused, certainly caused, by the anthrax vaccine to 5. All 5 of those were allergic inflammation reactions at the injection site. More importantly, since this program has been in effect, there has been nothing through the FDA's review or the AVEC's review of these VAERS 1s that have caused them to make any recommendation to change DOD's anthrax vaccine immunization program.
Well, thanks. You know, this vaccine goes down with this ominous wording in its package insert that it's a Category C vaccine for pregnancy. Mm-hmm. What does that mean? Is this safe for pregnant women?
All vaccines in the United States, without exception, carry that Category C on their product insert. It simply means that the FDA does not require studies, clinical studies, on adverse effects on pregnancy prior to distributing it and approving it for human use. The anthrax vaccine, likewise, had no long-term studies.
Okay.
All vaccines, then, that are Category C are simply deferred during pregnancy in women.
Okay, we have soldiers occasionally ask us, can this cause infertility, sterility, cancer? Do you have any data in those regards?
No vaccine currently in the United States has ever been shown to have an adverse impact on fertility in males or females subsequent to taking a dose of vaccine, anthrax included.
Okay, I guess one of the big concerns that comes up with regards to this vaccine, and one that's been brought up to me many times, is some of the studies, the early studies that led to its licensure, seem to indicate that, okay, it works against cutaneous anthrax. But right. The real question is, does this vaccine protect against aerosolized anthrax?
The Brockman study, of course, is the field trial study that brought this to licensure. It was a study during the 1950s in four textile mills in the northeastern United States. They looked at a cohort of about 450 individuals vaccinated with the anthrax vaccine. During the course of the four-year study, there were 26 cases of anthrax. The majority of those 21 cases were cutaneous, and yes, protection at about the 92.5% level was afforded. The other five cases of anthrax were inhalational anthrax cases. All those cases were in the unvaccinated population. However, because of the small number of inhalational cases, there could be no statistical significance given to that data. Now, over the course of the last several years, there have been numerous animal studies done, most importantly those to non-human primates. In every single study, the results have found that when challenged with aerosolized anthrax, there is protection at the 95 to 98 percentile in those non-human primates. We've also done studies on the antibody response, human antibody response to the anthrax vaccine. Again, we see a good antibody response. After the second dose of anthrax vaccine, 91% of those persons who have had that second dose show an antibody response. After the third dose, that increases to 95%. With every subsequent dose past that, up to the sixth dose, it approaches 100% of an antibody response in the human population. And so even though we have a paucity of data of human inhalational anthrax challenges, in fact, it would be unethical to do any more studies, this animal data and the antibody response in humans provides compelling evidence that this would protect against inhalation challenges.
Well, that certainly makes me feel better, certainly encouraging news. It seems, though, that every time I turn around, there's a TV program or an article discussing people who are refusing the vaccine. And I wondered how much of a deal this is or how big a deal this is. How many people are refusing? What's the refusal rate out there?
DOD has no formal report on refusals. We do know by conversations with the services and with their lawyers that we have about 200,000 refusals to date. All those refusals, by the way, are being separated from the service.
Okay, and I think you know as well as I do that during our experience in Operation Desert Storm, 150,000 or so soldiers mm-hmm. received at least one dose of the anthrax vaccine. Now, one concern that was raised by people who were receiving the vaccine at that time is that they were afraid that the vaccine is associated with perhaps some of the Gulf War illnesses or the illnesses in Gulf War veterans returning from that war. And I wondered if you had any data or any information in that regard.
Ted, this has been looked at extensively by military and non-military scientific panels. They all conclude that there is no evidence of any link between the anthrax vaccine use during Desert Shield, Desert Storm, and illnesses found among Gulf War veterans.
Okay, we hear concerns that some strains of anthrax might be resistant to the vaccine. Is that possible? Is it possible that anthrax strains be resistant to our vaccine?
We don't think so. Technologically, this would be very difficult to do. We don't know of any strains of anthrax that this would be resistant to. By the very fact that it's made up from the protective antigen, and that component is common among all naturally occurring strains, we would believe that it would protect against all of these.
Okay, so antibiotic resistance really doesn't have much to do with vaccine resistance, and an antibiotic strain I wouldn't assume would be resistant to vaccine. But what about genetically engineered products? Is it possible the Soviets could have genetically engineered an anthrax strain that is somehow resistant to our vaccine?
We have no evidence of that. Technologically, it is possible. However, remember, for the very reasons that anthrax is this unique, very dangerous bacillus, this organism, makes it also perfect to weaponize. And if you change that in any way, it makes it less perfect as a disease, less perfect to weaponize, less stable.
Well, thanks very much, Randy, and I hope that calms a lot of fears out there and puts some people's minds at ease. Now, vaccine issues are certainly the ones we get the most questions about. We've tried to answer some of those questions here right up front, but I'm sure there are many, many questions still lingering out there. You can find the answers to many of your questions, hopefully, at the anthrax vaccine website, and the web address for that site is www.anthrax.osd.mil. Now, we know we've thrown a lot at you already, so what we're going to do now is give you the opportunity to take a break for the next 15 minutes. At the same time, please remember, send in your faxes, and you can fax them or send them in to this number, 1-888-361-4011. Now, when we return from the break, we'll move on to the second of our bacterial diseases, plague. So enjoy your 15-minute break, and we'll see you back after then.
Sergeant Archibald?
Hey, sir, he's got some respiratory distress and he's starting to cough up a little bloody sputum.
Oh, okay. He doesn't look good.
Let's get a blood pressure.
Hey, you're going to be all right, Hoare.
Put him on a pulse ox. Let's give him some oxygen.
All right. Okay, sir, got it.
I want to listen to his lung feels. Let's bag him with 100%, please. Right.
Okay, got it, sir.
We'll listen to his lung feels.
Got it.
He sounds real junky. Do we have any history from this guy?
He's my soldier, sir.
About
4 or 5 days he's been coughing up stuff. I got 3 or 4 other soldiers that are really sick, too. They're coughing up blood. The medic says he doesn't know really what it is.
Hey, hold this for me.
You want lab stock?
Yeah, I want to get a CBC.
Okay.
And let's get some blood cultures, too.
Okay, I'm in. I got the blood.
He's starting to throw up. Let me get the suction, please. Keep bagging him. Keep bagging him until we get the suction over here. All right. Let's suction him out. Okay, that's good. That's real bloody stuff. I want to send some of that for a gram stain, okay? A little bit better seal
the
there.
Sorry, Archibald.
Is it going to be okay, Doc?
All right.
I hope so.
Well, how you feeling,
Hoare? 4 days ago, there was a blast attack, a chemical attack, we thought it was, and none of the alarms or anything went off.
So, okay.
And that's when everyone started getting sick.
All right, there we go.
He's been thinking up pretty well now.
There we go.
Pulse ox is about 95. Right. You got that second line in, Fred?
Yeah.
Yeah, both
okay, already got it, sir. Both of them running.
Okay. Do I have any lab results back yet? Oh, okay. Oh, he's got gram-negative rods.
Well, welcome back, everyone. Before we get started on our next disease, I just wanted to correct something I think I may have misunderstood, and this may be my fault. I have this little microphone in my ear where my director yells at me throughout the course of the day. But I think during the last section with Colonel Randolph, I heard him say that there were 200,000 refusals of anthrax vaccine. And again, if that's what I heard, then I wanted to correct that. There have actually been about 200 refusals. And while each one of those soldiers, sailors, or airmen who refuses certainly generates a fair amount of press coverage, I'd like you to put that into context with the over 1 million doses of anthrax vaccine that have been given out to date. And if you do a little bit of rough mathematical calculations, the refusal rate amongst anthrax vaccinees or potential anthrax vaccinees is actually about 0.06%. Well, let me tell you, as a pediatrician, I would be ecstatic if 99.94% of my mothers accepted my recommendation. So I think our record actually isn't so bad in that regard. But without further ado, let's get on with today's broadcast. And I want to welcome back Dr. Denise Koo from CDC. Welcome back, Denise.
Well, thanks, Ted. I must say that, Roland, that was the fastest gram scene in the West.
Well, you know, Denise, that's not very unusual for our military hospitals. They all operate with blazing speed and efficiency. And in fact, I have a good friend who's a recruiter, and he probably could get you switched over from the Public Health Service to the Army. So why don't you come join us?
Well, thanks for the offer, Ted, but I've got enough at the CDC to keep me busy for well over a lifetime.
Okay, then. Well, let's move on to plague. Now, I think you all know, as well as we do, that the mere mention of the word plague conjures up images of destruction in many people's minds. And plague, for the studio audience out there, is another of the great diseases of antiquity, just like anthrax is. There have been three global pandemics of plague in recorded history. We right now are in the third pandemic. The first of those pandemics was often referred to as the Plague of Justinian. It peaked at about 541. And some scholars feel it put the final nail in the coffin of the Byzantine Empire. The second pandemic of plague is the one that is referred to in folklore as the Black Death. It peaked in about the 1350s, 1360s in continental Europe and killed a third of the population of Europe. And then the modern pandemic, the third pandemic that we're in right now, began in about 1898. Let's listen to a little background history on plague, as well as some history on its use as a biological weapon. And I think that'll give you a more of a feeling for the potential of this disease.
Man has used organisms found in nature to kill or disable his enemies since the Middle Ages. One of the earlier examples occurred in the 14th century when the Tatar army laid siege to Kaffa, a walled city along the Black Sea. When an outbreak of bubonic plague began to ravage the Tatars, they decided to catapult the plague-ridden corpses into the city, thereby hoping to start an outbreak within the walls. Shortly thereafter, the Genoese defenders within the city were stricken with plague and fled to Italy. They carried this infection with them to Europe, beginning the outbreak of the horrible Black Death, which decimated the European population. With our current knowledge of the epidemiology of plague, we know that fleas leave a body quickly after it cools. Therefore, it's most likely that the outbreak was actually spread in Kaffa by flea-infested rats, which were already within the city. The Japanese Imperial Unit 731 operated in the 1930s and 40s when Japan was mobilized and ready for war. General Shiro Ishii, mastermind of this terrible program, had a mission: to turn illness into weapons of murder. Ishii was particularly fascinated by plague because with plague, a BW attack could present like a natural epidemic. Person-to-person spread could then produce disease out of proportion to the original amount of agent used. The Japanese were unable to disseminate plague by either aerosol or in the water supply, so they used nature's vector for spreading the disease, the common flea. Ceramic bombs loaded with infected fleas were dropped over several cities in mainland China, causing large outbreaks among their populations. Plague is attractive as a weapon because it generates fear, it spreads easily, and it kills very quickly. The United States Offensive Program did some research on plague, but it was never fully weaponized in this country. We could not overcome the challenge of maintaining virulence when it was grown in large quantities.
It's just as well, I guess, is that we didn't weaponize plague, because it's a weapon that, you know, it's a contagious agent, and we felt that in retrospect that we had enough problems controlling an aerosol under meteorological conditions that can change without having an organism that is so contagious so that, you know, you're not able to control where that organism might end up. It might come back to bite you, not only bite your forces, but some of your friendly allied forces also.
Plague was, however, a favorite organism in the Soviet arsenal because of its communicability. The Soviets overcame the virulence problems experienced by the U.S. According to interviews with a Soviet defector, Dr. Alibek, they had 1,500 metric tons of plague on hand at any given time and kept it ready for use in their intercontinental ballistic missiles. Due to storage problems, they frequently recycled their stockpile of plague with fresh agent. We're very concerned about terrorist use of plague because the agent is found not only in nature, but also in numerous biological supply houses throughout the world.
Well, Denise, we certainly heard some chilling tidbits, I guess you could say, about the history of plague. Why don't you start us off now by talking about the microbiology of this disease?
Plague is a disease that results from infection by the bacteria Yersinia pestis. The organism is a non-modal, gram-negative rod, and when stained, it's easy to see the unique bipolar properties characteristic of this organism, as in the picture here. It's often described as looking like a safety pin. Yersinia pestis organisms have two important properties that differ from Bacillus anthracis. First, they are transmissible person to person. And second, they do not produce spores.
Okay, what does clinical plague look like?
The three clinical manifestations of plague, and with naturally occurring plague, the most common form is bubonic plague. This form is characterized by development of an acute regional lymphadenopathy, or swollen lymph nodes, near the site of exposure. We call these swollen, painful lymph nodes buboes. Septicemic plague occurs when Yersinia pestis invades and continues to multiply in the bloodstream. This can occur secondarily to bubonic plague or can develop without any detectable buboes. Pneumonic plague is actually the least common, but the most dangerous and fatal form of the disease.
Okay, let's listen now to an expert on plague, Colonel Russ Byrne, who's chief of bacteriology at USAMRIID up at Fort Detrick, and he's going to describe for us some of the pathogenesis of plague.
The pathogenesis of pneumonic plague occurs two ways. The first is as a complication of bubonic plague. The infection progresses untreated to invade the bloodstream, followed by seeding of the lungs with progressive pneumonia. The other way Yersinia pestis causes pneumonic plague is when it's introduced as an aerosol, as a bioagent. In that setting, it's deposited in the alveoli, taken up by alveolar macrophages, and then transported by lymphatics to local lymph nodes. After this, the change in temperature results in a transformation of the organism. It starts making a lot of the F1 capsule, which protects against phagocytosis. In addition, a lot of virulence factors are produced. This accelerates the infection and is probably responsible for the rapid downhill course in untreated pneumonic plague. Death usually occurs within 2 to 5 days after the onset of illness. If effective treatment is not initiated within 24 hours, death usually results from pneumonic plague.
Okay, Denise, right now we're in the third global pandemic of plague, and that would tell me that I should be seeing or I might be expected to see cases of plague. Why are we not seeing more human cases of plague?
Actually, plague continues to be an endemic problem in various parts of the world, but we have only a handful of human cases reported each year in the United States, mostly of the bubonic type. You can see here on this graph the number of reported human cases in the U.S. from 1967 to 1997. And of course, the reason we still have human plague in the U.S. is because, as we heard earlier, it's a zoonotic disease that's transmitted largely by wild rodents and their fleas to other animals and people.
Okay, I think Bill Patrick explained pretty well some of the problems and challenges of weaponizing plague and why it might or might not be a weapon or a viable weapon to certain enemies out there on the battlefield. Again, I want to remind the people out in the audience, plague is transmitted from person to person, and that might make it a less attractive weapon to the battlefield commander. And as I told you earlier, one of the main tenets of most battlefield commanders is maintain control of the battlefield. Plague might be a very awesome and fearsome weapon, weapon in one sense, but it is contagious. And furthermore, there's no effective vaccine. So if I use it as a weapon, I subsequently march my troops through, I have to worry that they're going to get plague. And I really have no good way to protect them from getting plague. What's more, as you've already heard, plague is a vector-borne disease. It's transmitted by fleas, and those fleas are carried by rats. So when I release my weapon, not only do I infect everybody around me, but I infect all the fleas and rats in the area as well. So I've got to worry about them also. And my problems or the range of infectivity goes well beyond the initial people I intended to affect. So if I'm a battlefield commander, I want to maintain control of the battlefield. Maybe plague isn't that attractive of a weapon. On the other hand, if I'm a terrorist and I want to leverage my gains, then maybe plague looks very attractive indeed. Now, let's return to those intrepid doctors on clinical rounds in virtual hospital, and I think you're going to see they probably have another fascinating patient. Today, they're fortunate in that Dr. Tom Butler, a world-renowned plague expert from the University of Texas, just happened to be visiting virtual hospital when this particular patient presented to the staff.
Hello, PSC Williams. The doctors are here to see you.
PSC Williams, I brought a couple other doctors to come see you. I have Dr. Butler, who is one of our outside consultants here visiting. He's an infectious disease physician. In addition, I have Lieutenant Colonel Cieslak, who's one of our infectious disease docs. Just want to give you a brief rundown on what's the course of illness. He was on exercise in California for about a week with his unit, returned yesterday. About midnight last night, had the acute onset of rigors, chills, chest pain, and a fever, temp about 102, 103, coughing up some greenish sputum. He's deteriorated throughout the course of the day despite treatment with erythromycin and ceftriaxone, and he's developed hemoptysis over the course of the day.
Hemoptysis, huh? You know, that, of course, presents an interesting differential. Obviously, tuberculosis can cause that. Staphylococcal pneumonia comes to mind, pneumococcal pneumonia. Of course, if he was elderly or debilitated, then Klebsiella, really any gram-negative pneumonia can do this.
Were other members of his unit involved?
Well, he was on this exercise with members of his unit. There are about four others who have presented with similar constellation of symptoms at about the same time course. Hmm.
I would like to examine him.
Sure.
He's by far the worst of the five.
Mr. Williams, does it hurt you when you take a deep breath? Right here.
Sharp.
Would you breathe? Yes, I hear rattles in the chest, confirming the presence of pneumonia. Was there a gram stain done on the sputum?
Yes, his gram stain showed multiple polys and gram-negative rods. In addition, his CBC showed a white count of about 20,000 with a left shift, and we did blood cultures too, which are pending.
Well, with the presence of gram-negative rods in the sputum and several people involved, suggests an outbreak, and this could be plague.
Plague?
Sir, if you're thinking it's plague, will standard respiratory masks be okay?
We should wear masks, all
right
of us
now,
here in this room, to protect ourselves against droplet spread.
Hmm. Do we need HEPA filter masks or surgical masks already?
Oh, surgical masks will be useful. The other important thing to do is get effective antibiotic to treat this possible plague infection.
What did you say you had him on?
Ceftriaxone and erythromycin.
Well, he needs to have either streptomycin, a tetracycline, or chloramphenicol. Is there streptomycin available in the formulary?
Not streptomycin, no.
Well, could we get doxycycline, 100 milligrams intravenously, as soon as possible?
Right now?
Can we go ahead and do that now?
Sure.
Isn't gentamicin another alternative?
Yes. Yeah, gentamicin should work as well as streptomycin.
We should have that as well.
Sir, I'd like to show you the chest x-ray if I could.
Yes, there is an infiltrate in the right lower lobe, and I see some pleural fluid here, suggesting pleural involvement, explaining his right-sided pleuritic chest pain, which is common with plague pneumonia.
Dr. Butler, is this a typical clinical presentation that you'd see with pneumonic plague?
Yes, when pneumonic plague is primary, that is, a patient inhales an aerosol. In about 3 days after exposure, patients will develop fever, chills, and cough, shortness of breath. Sometimes the symptoms are nonspecific, including headache, muscle aches.
Now, could this be secondary? Could he have bubonic plague that's generalized to the lungs or spread to the lungs?
Yes. Some patients with pneumonic plague will be secondary to a bubo, which is a tender and large lymph node.
Did he have any physical examples? No, not physical.
Well, then this is probably a primary inhalational plague. There have been two patients in the United States well described who handled sick cats. The cats had pneumonic plague, and 3 days after the exposure, they became sick, and both of them died, which was about 3 days after the onset of symptoms. Now, we can say we're very fortunate that Mr. Williams came to us in less than 24 hours, and we expect you to do well with the antibiotic treatment. However, if treatment is delayed beyond 24 hours, most patients do not have a good outcome.
Now, what about other people in his unit who were not ill at this time? Of course, we'll treat the others who are ill similarly as soon as possible. What about the members who were there with him in California but were not are not ill right now?
They should receive prophylactic antibiotic, and the choice is tetracycline or trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole.
Doxycycline will work, I'm sure.
Yes.
Now, what about the healthcare providers, people who've been taking care of him?
They should also receive prophylaxis.
Okay.
Major Nurgis, can we get a hold of his commander and try to get those unit members rounded up?
I'll give him a call. I'll bring him into the ER. You can see him there.
Okay.
Well, I really appreciate both of you coming today and sharing your expertise with us. PSC Williams, I think you're going to do okay, right?
Yeah,
you got the medicine going already.
PSC Williams, I'll be back in a few minutes to take care of you.